Greetings and welcome to the Asian American and Asian Research Institute's Friday Lecture Series online edition. My name is Anthony Wong, Program Coordinator of the Institute. Thank you very much for joining us for our talk tonight by Vina Orden on her CUNY Forum essay, Black Henry, Charting New Ways Forward in a Filipino History. Vina presents a critique of colonial Spanish and Filipino history utilizing Filipino journalist, poet, and playwright Luis H. Francia's play, Black Henry, as a radical work of imagination and jumping off point to deconstruct colonial history. Vina Orden is a writer, artist, and immigrants' rights and social justice advocate based in New York City. Her writing about the Filipino community has appeared in Asian American Writers' Workshop's The Margins, Hella Pinay, Hyperallergic, Asian Journal, The Phil-Am, and elsewhere. Orden is a 2022 Open City Fellow and is currently an editor of poetry and creative nonfiction at Slanted Magazine. She's also a co-host along with Tamara Crawford of The Uplift, a monthly transatlantic conversation about books, writing, identity, and representation. Orden was a writer and cast member of the award-winning 2019 production of Ray's Panay. She was a participant in Tin House's 2022 Young Adult Workshop. A Kweli Sing the Truth mentee, and is working on her first novel for young adults. You can follow her on Twitter and Instagram at hyphenated, that's hyffeinated, or visit her website at vinaorden.com. And with that, please welcome Vina Orden.
I do want to thank Anthony and the Asian American Asian Research Institute at CUNY. As Anthony mentioned, I had written an essay in the most recent issue of CUNY Forum, which you can definitely buy off the website. And it is, and so that's the what my presentation will be about is the essay that I wrote for that. The title of my talk is Black Henry, Reimagining a Moment in Filipino History to Chart New Ways Forward. And so I think as Filipinos and really anyone who was formerly colonized by the Spanish, you may know that 2021 marked the quincentennial of Ferdinand Magellan and Juan Sebastian Elcano's circumnavigation of the earth. So revisiting this event now seems timely. It is Filipino American History Month in October, but also recently, I mean, a few months back, we witnessed the reactions to the passing of Queen Elizabeth. And so there were those, of course, who saw her and the monarchy as symbols of stability through all these global upheavals over the many decades. But then there were also those who really sought accountability and reparatory justice from the violence, exploitation, and intergenerational trauma of the British Empire. And what was fascinating to me were the number of people who were shocked, you know, who were righteously indignant that not everyone was mourning the Queen's death. And that whole scenario reminded me of what Elaine Castillo refers to as the unexpected reader in her book of essays, How to Read Now. So Castillo talks about mainstream literature really prioritizing the comfort and understanding of the quote-unquote expected reader. So that is generally, you know, the white, cis-straight male reader. But what we can say, I feel like we can say the same thing about the mainstream history that we're taught in schools. And, you know, the unexpected post-colonial reader really faces a lot of indignation when we call out what the dominant culture chooses to document and uphold, as well as withhold, the kind of violence of the silence of the archives, to paraphrase Sadia Hartman. Like when we assert that Black Lives Matter, we're rejecting white supremacy. When we call for Indigenous rights and land stewardship, we're rejecting the legacy of settler colonialism, of extracting maximum capital from the land. And when we tear down monuments, we are, as Elaine Castillo points out, rejecting how the dominant culture teaches us to read our past and thereby live in our present. So today's talk is about historical events, but it's ultimately about how we read, interpret, deconstruct, and reframe those events. So in this case, as Anthony mentioned earlier, I use Louis H. Francia's play, Black Henry, and the Atlantic Pacific's transnational production in 2021 to explore a more subaltern cultural response to European quincentennial celebrations of the Magellan-Elcano circumnavigation. So on August 24, 2020, Spain's 93rd Marine Guard set sail from a naval station in Cadiz for its 11th scheduled midshipman training cruise, except this particular voyage was also pageantry. From the ship's name, so you see the ship here, Juan Sebastian Elcano, to its route west across the Atlantic to South America through the Straits of Magellan, and across the Pacific to Guam and the Philippines. And also, a fun little fact, there were two celebratory casks of 12-year Amontillado stowed on board for this particular journey. So it definitely was, you know, a commemoration of the quincentennial of the Magellan-Elcano circumnavigation. But what exactly was being commemorated depended on who was asked. The dominant Eurocentric narrative celebrates Ferdinand Magellan's attempt in 1519, ultimately completed by Elcano in 1522 to circumnavigate the globe, birthing the process of globalization. But increasingly, scholars from the global south have challenged these claims, pointing out that commerce and the exchange of ideas among communities across Asia, North Africa, and the Mediterranean long predated European colonialism, even positing that Magellan's enslaved guide and interpreter, Enrique de Malaca, also known as Enrique el Negro or Henry the Black, whom Malaysians and Filipinos equally claim as one of their own, actually may have been the first person to circumnavigate the globe from Cebu in the central Philippines, what's now the central Philippines, to Malacca in Malaysia, to Portugal, to Spain, and then back to Cebu. Interestingly, the arrival of the ship Elcano in Cebu City in 2021 elicited reassurances from John G. Gonzalez of the Office of the Presidential Assistant for the Visayas Region that we will not celebrate the discovery of the Philippines. We will commemorate the quincentennial the Filipino way, which means we will raise awareness of our countrymen about the rich yet challenging pre-Hispanic or pre-colonial history. And then on the other hand, you had the mayor of Cebu City, Edgar Labella, strike a more festive note, despite having to cancel all these large-scale quincentennial events because we were in the middle of the COVID-19 pandemic. So the mayor said, "Today, we relive history as it happened 500 years ago when Fernando Magellanes set foot in Cebu, which gave birth to our Christianity." So I think these two statements demonstrate Filipinos' ongoing struggle with colonial legacies that are so deeply entwined with and some might argue inextricable from their own ancestral legacies. So the image on this slide is from the Boxer Codex. It's a Spanish manuscript from around 1590 that features 75 illustrations of various ethnic groups in Asia, in Micronesia, including what you see here, the pintados, or the tattooed people of the Visayas, which is now the central Philippines, whom Magellan encountered on this journey. And our knowledge about the Magellan-Elcano circumnavigation and the very, very little that we know of Enrique de Malaca draws largely from the chronicles of Antonio Picafetta, an Italian scholar who was among the 18 survivors of the original 270 who set sail from Spain in August of 1519. As an enslaved person, Enrique, referred to as Magellan's slave for most of the journal, a dozen or so times, and then named exactly once in the journal's final mention of him, which you see here on this slide. He makes an unusual appearance in the text for at least two reasons. One, that he served as interpreter and primary interlocutor with the people of Cebu, who Pigafetta claims, he spoke their language, but that is debatable according to scholars today. And that he was blamed for conspiring with Raja Humabon, ruler of Cebu, to lure some of the crew members onshore to a banquet where they met their bloody end. And it also must be noted that scholars are now casting a more critical eye on different versions of Pigafetta's accounts. They're, extant, I think, two Italian, an Italian and then two French French versions of the manuscript. And so Enrique's own fate is uncertain. So we know he doesn't make it back to Spain, but did that mean that he perished along the way on the ship? Or did he manage to gain his freedom as promised in Magellan's will and remain behind in Cebu, for instance? So Colombian writer Gabriel Garcia Marquez delivered his assessment of Pigafetta in his 1982 Nobel lecture. Garcia Marquez says, Pigafetta wrote, upon his passage through our southern lands of America, a strictly accurate account that nonetheless resembles a venture into fantasy. And Garcia Marquez connects Pigafetta and all these, fantastical Renaissance travel writers to contemporary cultural critics when he says, Europeans of goodwill, and sometimes those of bad as well, have been struck with ever greater force by the unearthly tidings of Latin America. That boundless realm of haunted men and historic women whose unending obstinacy blurs into legend. The interpretation of our reality through patterns not of our own serves only to make us ever more unknown, ever less free, ever more solitary. Venerable Europe would perhaps be more perceptive if it tried to see us in its own past. And it appears that Filipino journalist, poet, and playwright Luis H. Francia, who I believe is watching this evening, hello Luis, shares Garcia Marquez's concerns regarding the West's appetite for drama and heroes that's disassociated from the cultural, political, and economic realities. In his narrative, A History of the Philippines from Indios Bravos to Filipinos, Francia writes that Pigafetta's description of Humabon's banquet is a scene worthy of Shakespeare. And this was something fun that I thought was appropriate to share in this talk. It was a meme that was circulating on social media for Indigenous Peoples Day at the start of Phil M History Month. So for those somewhat familiar with this story, you'll recognize as the protagonists, the legendary explorer Magellan, and the Filipino folk hero Lapu-Lapu, popularly credited as Magellan's vanquisher in the Battle of Mactan, but who more than likely was actually among a group of warriors who took Magellan down. But from French's perspective, equally important to this cataclysmic story is a person who sits in history's shadow, the enslaved Enrique. Perhaps journalists and writers of color are inclined to gravitate toward marginalized or untold stories, but in the absence of documentation, how and what can we hope to contribute to our understanding of a historically significant moment and its aftermath? So these are the central preoccupations in French's play, Black Henry, which had its global virtual premiere in April of 2021, sponsored by SULU, the Philippine Studies Initiative, and the King Juan Carlos I of Spain Center at New York University, and the Atlantic Pacific Theater's production. which was directed by Clara de los Reyes, founder and director of APT, and which featured a global cast of actors from New York City, Los Angeles, San Francisco, Seattle, and the Philippines. And for the most part, the play is consistent with the known historical narrative of Magellan's landfall in Cebu and then later Mactan, but as a work of imagination, departs from it in critical ways. So the play opens with an animation of three tall ships, which are what remained of Magellan's Armada de Molucca, advancing from a fiery orange horizon toward the port city of Cebu. And we have a clip of that thanks to APT. And hopefully you'll be able to hear the sound here. Oops, skipped ahead. So rather than opening with a scene on board Magellan's ship, which is how the Pigafetta narrative, that's the perspective, Francia refracts the Pigafetta's gaze and begins the play in the great hall of the palace of the local ruler, Rahahumabon, who's played by John Roque. In the production. Here, Humabon, Siamese trader and advisor Abbas, played by Anthony Vaughn Merchant, and Princess Ilang, played by Kriana House, not only set the stage for the events that are about to unfold, but also situates Magellan's invasion within the context of local, cultural, political, and economic realities that are absent from Pigafetta's narrative. So I am going to read a bit from that scene, and pardon me, I'm not an actor. So I am gonna read from the script. Rahahumabon says, "We can work, drink, and feast together without anyone adopting anyone else's beliefs." Princess Ilang responds, "The way we've always worked with merchants from Guangdong and Fujian, from Okinawa, Java, and Sumatra." Humabon, "The way we've worked with you and the Kingdom of Siam, we all benefit from each other's trade without having to bow to the same gods." Abbas, "These Christians are different. They will gladly kill and enslave in the name of their God and their king. My lord, considering who Magellan is and where he comes from, you will be at least considered a little brother, at worst a slave meant to serve him and his king." So Francia's choice of the words little brother recalls a pejorative for Filipinos, little brown brothers, which was coined by William Howard Taft, the first American colonial governor general of the Philippines in the early 20th century. It is apt to invoke the phrase in this opening scene of Black Henry, which reframes the story as one of native people defending their sovereignty against colonialism versus Pigafetta's story of Christian white supremacists taking up the burden of civilizing quote-unquote heathens. Switch to the next slide. So voiceless in Pigafetta's chronicle, and I don't think it's surprising, are the women, mentioned only as objects of the male gaze and of their sexual fulfillment. So it was a notable decision, I thought, by Francia to write women actors into the script. Humabon's nephew and aide in real life becomes Princess Ilang in the play. And then to the consternation of the Europeans, particularly Padre Valderrama, played in the production by Artem Yatsunov, both Ilang and Rani Humamai, played by Eloisa Cardona, try to explain that in their part of the world, men think it best to leave matters of the spirit to the women. And later on in the play, and that's where this still that you see right now, Lapu-Lapu, who's played by Alexis Cummins, seeks the advice of a Babaylan, also played by Cardona, before the Battle of Mactan. As Francia notes in his history of the Philippines, the Babaylan, also known as Catalonan or Mumbaki, most often were women and occasionally trans, intersex, or gender-fluid people. They were augurs of fate, as well as healers and midwives, as bearers of life and as mediums who could communicate with the dead. The Babaylan occupied a prominent and lucrative position in society. Gender equity and nonconformity also reflected in a number of the pre-colonial languages and myths were so threatening to the misogynistic Spanish colonizers that they systemically murdered the Babaylan. It's even said that to ensure their total annihilation, the Babaylan's bodies were chopped up and fed to crocodiles. So Ilang's character allows Francia to compare the conditions of women before and after colonization. As Enrique's love interest, Ilang also illustrates the islanders' fluid social hierarchy relative to the Spanish. Pre-colonial Lusones and Visayans, who lived in the north and the central regions of the archipelago, did have ruling elites and enslaved people, but as historian Vicente Rafael elaborates, status reflected indebtedness, not the person. Self and status were not naturally related, but explicitly constructed on the basis of asymmetrical exchanges, so marriage alliances, usurpations of authority, trade relations, and so on. Indeed, the possibility of shifting from one rank to another, as evidenced by the fine gradations of servitude, bespoke the tendency to disassociate status from the person. So in their final conversation in the production, Magellan, played by James Rana, informs Enrique, played by Ives Bagayong from the Philippines, of a provision in his will making him a free man. Enrique wonders if it means that he could marry whomever he wants and live anywhere in the world, before recognizing that the Spanish would spurn him because of his skin color and his lowly station. Whereas by simply securing his freedom, he would be able to marry Ilang. So toward the end of Francia's play, Enrique is fatally wounded in a skirmish after a banquet. His body is buried under a cairn by the sea, bathed by saltwater waves, as you see here. And Ilang and Humabon in this scene look on as Abbas basically recites an Islamic funeral prayer. Enrique's non-Christian burial is juxtaposed with the play's final scene, which you also see here, where Rani Humamay rechristened Juana after Spanish King Carlos I's mother, recites the Pater Noster under the tutelage of Padre Valderrama, who stays behind on the islands to spread Christian dogma. So Pigafetta's own account of Rani Humamay's conversion really is quite dramatic. He says, "I showed her an image of Our Lady, a very beautiful child Jesus made of wood, and a cross. Thereupon, she was seized with contrition and weeping, asked for baptism." That's probably why the play ends with this close-up shot of the Santo Niño de Cebu, which is really, it's a statuette of the child Jesus, and it's very ubiquitous in the Philippines. You even see it in, like, car dashboards. So these juxtaposed scenes of Enrique's burial and the Rani's conversion allude to the cultural hybridity of the modern Filipino. While the Philippines is still predominantly Catholic or Christian, about 10% of the population is Muslim. Many Christianized Filipinos still retain regional pre-colonial beliefs and traditions, including consulting alternative healers. So the faith healer, if you're familiar with that, is a really good example of this hybridity that taps into both indigenous healing practices as well as Christian prayers and rituals. So in the talk back after the premiere, playwright Francia discussed centering the play on Enrique, who for him represented modern day concerns, particularly the overseas Filipino worker, workers in the merchant marines and the cruise industry, where Filipinos make up the bulk of workers. And this parallelism of Enrique and the OFW who returns to the motherland also was observed by Filipino filmmaker Kidla Tehimik and was the subject of his 2015 film, Balikbayan 1, Memories of Overdevelopment, Redux 3. It's really great and wonderful, and you could probably find some footage of that movie on YouTube. So Francia began researching and writing Black Henry in Cebu in 2003. And in 2014, director and actor Clara de los Reyes participated in a reading of the play at Topaz Arts here in New York City. And in 2020, he and Francia started discussing staging a production of Black Henry. And then, of course, as we know, the pandemic hit. So while a traditional in-person premiere wasn't possible, De Los Reyes began to think about the possibilities of a virtual production and what all of that could possibly enable. He was connected to theater makers in Manila and across the U.S., but collaborating across space and time zones was actually often really cost prohibitive. But online theater turned that dream into a reality, allowing him to bring transnational aesthetics to a transnational play. It was also an opportunity to decolonize arts and cultural spaces that often limit who participates and who has access to these experiences. De Los Reyes, along with other cast members, had to contend with a medium that posed challenges and opportunities similar to, as well as different from, live theater and film. To double down on the opportunities of online theater, as well as to develop a visual language to match this transnational play and cast, in De Los Reyes' words, deviating from colonial capitalist structures and aesthetics, he relied on a community of professionals in and outside theater. Francis Estrada, a visual artist and educator, who as a Kali or a Filipino martial arts instructor as well, also choreographed the fight scenes in the show. There was Charles Reynoso, video producer and educator, and Cynthia Alberto, artist, designer, and founder of the Brooklyn-based art studio Weaving Hand. The efforts of live production, online realization, and staging fell on Leia Cabrera and Isabel Duverger of NYU. So a challenge of performing a play, and a history play at that, is bridging the distance between to the contemporary audience. So the symbiotic relationship that develops between the actors and the audience is really unique and vital to every live performance. In online theater, the physical distance to that audience is negated, and this, in this respect, resembles film more closely. An intimacy with the audience in film is often achieved by the camera through close-up and extreme close-up shots. So I think over a year into the pandemic, where many of us have become familiar with the close-up or extreme shots of our coworkers and family members on a Zoom screen, right? So the narrow frame was a limitation that I think the production was really able to not just work around, but also harness for intimate moments. Like in this scene, for instance, where Ilang and Enrique declare their love for each other, and also another scene where Magellan promises to set Enrique free. And credit really goes to the actors Kriana Haas, Ibes Bagadyong, and James Rana, who express a range of emotions through subtle and natural shifts in their facial expressions and voices. It's just really amazing to watch that professionalism. And who also manage from the confines of their own homes, you know, scattered across the country and in the Philippines, to connect with the other actors on a virtual stage set. to address the limitations of Zoom while at the same time push the boundaries of open broadcaster software, Francis Estrada and Charles Reynoso drew on multiple art forms such as graphic novels, manga, and Southeast Asian shadow plays to create the visual aesthetic of the production. Designer Cynthia Alberto, who was inspired by ancient European, Asian, Latin American, and African weaving traditions, hand wove the costumes based on creative interpretations of the era from zero waste fabric scraps that were donated by a fashion designer. So ultimately, the team's innovative interdisciplinary approach disrupts the norms of current online theater and also expands the possibility for a medium in its nascency. So you'll see, you know, some of the backdrops here, which is a combination of vibrantly tinted black and white photographs. Some were actually taken by Estrada during previous trips to the Visayas and to Mactan. All of these things establish the settings in the play. You know, from the deck of the Bridge of Magellan ship to the interiors of Humabon and Lapu-Lapu's palaces to landscapes of the islands. And so also interspersed within all of this are live action montages of battle scenes like this one, which really move the plot along. There are, of course, also slower paced, quietly powerful scenes that help the audience better understand the characters' human motivations. This was just really, really fun to see. It's very cool. There is no sound with this particular video. And so as an example of one of these slower scenes, before his battle with Lapu-Lapu's men, Magellan is seen holding on to this wooden cross and fervently praying. This was actually a film element in the production. And so, it was filmed in this kind of high contrast black and white from angles behind, and then it also goes above Magellan, and with this voiceover track of kind of like Magellan's monologue through all of this. The overall effect is that it renders Magellan vulnerable. So when we come to his subsequent death in the Battle of Mactan, it garners the audience's sympathy. So when asked about the motivations behind his work as a writer and a professor, Francia often quotes this Tagalog saying, oftentimes attributed to Rizal, but I've been told by Luis it's actually just a regular old Tagalog saying. Ang hindi lumilingon sa pinanggalingan ay hindi makakarating sa paroroonan. If you don't know where you came from, you won't know where you're going. And so I think this is often a really complicated and laborious charge for people who've been marginalized in history and historiography. Of course, there are many ways that cultures have passed down knowledge over the millennia, including the oral traditions of poetry and theater. So in a sense, returning to those traditional ways of knowing with Black Henry conjures larger truths about the human experience. For instance, the simple fact of Enrique's and Filipino's multilingualism. I mean, most of us grow up learning at least two, if not more languages. So, our regional language, Filipino or Tagalog, English, and perhaps Spanish, speaks to the ways that Filipinos have survived and thrived by endeavoring to understand and to be understood in multicultural societies. Hybrid multilingual Filipinos have invented entirely new ways of seeing, thinking, and interpreting the world, something that's akin to what James Baldwin observed about Black English. Baldwin says, This was not merely an adoption of a foreign tongue, but an alchemy that transformed ancient elements into new language. A language comes into existence by means of brutal necessity, and the rules of the language are dictated by what the language must convey. That is so deep. And so French's play and de los Reyes's production interrogate the narratives of the past that have been advanced and accepted as truth, whether about Magellan's landfall on Cebu or about the conventions of theater making. And in doing so, they chart new ways forward from past and present uncertainties to future possibilities. Thank you so much.
Frank Gomez asks, does anti-Spanish animosity exist?
Anti-Spanish animosity. I'm not really sure what you mean by that, like as like racially or microaggressions. But I mean, I think even in you know, the literature from that time, if you read Rizal, I mean, certainly a lot of the writers and the folks who were involved in the Philippine Revolution against Spain, they were influenced by a lot of these movements around the world, including you know, the French Enlightenment. And so you will read these tracts that are definitely you know, very critical of the Spanish, as in really more critical of the political system that they created and the social hierarchies that they created in the Philippines. And so I don't know if I'm answering your specific question, but if you wanted to elaborate.
Frank says criticism of the colonial past.
Yeah, I mean, definitely. Actually, I will point to, there's this really, if you go to Salu, the Philippine Initiative at NYU, I think they might still have some artifacts from this virtual conference they did, Mactan 500. And you'll definitely see some really great scholarship that not only focuses actually on Spanish colonialism, but also changes the focus. So we're talking about like pericolonial societies. So societies within the archipelago that was never conquered by the Spanish, right? Or any of the subsequent conquered folks. Just to have a different frame of reference, the pericolonial reference, to show that there are these societies that have exist today that probably you know, have evolved much closer to keeping a lot of like the archipelagic belief systems and you know, even economic and trading systems. And if you really are interested in the scholarship, there's really a number of great folks, and you'll find them in the Mactan conference. There's Khalif Fajardo from the University of Minnesota. From UCLA, there's Dr. Una Paredes. Some really great stuff, coming out as well from a lot of the newer scholarship, I would say.
Frank follows up by saying, for example, in the US and Latam, there is a resistance to honoring Columbus. Latam, Columbus Day doesn't exist.
Yeah.
El Dia de la Raza. So
yeah.
Creation of a new race.
So. Yeah. It was so interesting. I mean, it's so fascinating. Politics in the Philippines just fascinates me to no end. But before the son of a dictator, Bongbong Marcos, became president, we had another, in my mind, dictator, Rodrigo Duterte. And, you know, it's like there was this massive statue of Lapu-Lapu that was erected in the same space where like there's Rizal's statue. And so during the commemoration, I think it was during the centennial the celebration of the Magellan-Elcano circumnavigation. Duterte actually issued this very nationalist, I proclaim Lapu-Lapu Day. So he used it as like this this way to kind of foment like nationalist sentiments, I guess. And so he used it in that way. And I know that there was a statue of Magellan in Cebu that was also torn down, just like the various statues in a lot of these formerly colonized places of Columbus, etc. Yeah.
Okay. We have a hand raised from Alan Isaac. I believe this is
maybe Alan.
So I think you raise a good point about the use of pre-colonial figures by authoritarian figures, sort of dictators, right? And so I was wondering how you would differentiate between ways that we can think through the pre-colonial past without it actually becoming a sort of weird status nationalist way, or even ethno-nationalist for that matter, even though I know recognizing the different regions in the Philippines, but there is a danger in that that you just pointed to right now. I was just wondering how do you measure precisely the or differentiate or distinguish between those types of uses to a more sort of pointing to different futures, I guess.
Yeah, one of the things that I found so great about this production actually was the transnational aspect of it, and I think that we have to get away from this sort of like Philippines base versus like Philippines in the diaspora kind of ridiculous discussions that go on sometimes about like things like the X in Philippine X and how that's like a horrible thing, because we actually have I think it's just so rich when we have these transnational conversations that's not just going on at a scholarly level. If you follow Twitter, actually there have been some really interesting conversations that have been happening in that space where we all contribute knowledge, right? Like our own our own different knowledges based on where we are. And so, for instance, I was invited to speak on Twitter Spaces about I really don't know that much about like Captain America, so I invited someone else who would be able to speak to that more. So I spoke more on kind of like the history, but apparently there's this Filipina Captain America as part of like the new series of Captain America, right? And that just, I was just like aghast by it. It was interesting because I think her name in Tagalog means like a woman's vagina. So there, that was the conversation that was happening on like the Twitter space. But just the realm of social media, I think. But in this particular conversation of Twitter Spaces, we really unpacked what that meant to have a Filipina like Captain America. And I think, and actually it was interesting because it was a theater person who has knowledge of, the comic book realm, and me, who's definitely not a scholar, I will say that I'm not an academic. I'm just, interested in Philippine history and stuff. And all these linguists from the Philippines. But it ended up being this just amazing conversation because I think they were very fascinated about what the Filipina American perspective would be to this whole scenario. So, I'm totally like babbling right now, but and I will invite you to answer your own question in a way, because I feel like you're right about this, Alan. But But I do think that, you know, having these kind of conversations in the public sphere and resting with our own history in kind of real ways. And I mean, you know, even in pop culture, right? Like it is an interesting phenomenon that there are a lot of, you know, Filipino writers who are going back to like the myths and all of that stuff and creating something new from it. And you can go either way about, you know, saying, oh, like, is this creating some like weird nationalistic thing? But I don't think so. In those cases, they're going beyond it and really using what's in our history and culture, yeah, to create like future possibilities and to think about things in all these different ways. What is that series on Netflix about? Oh my gosh, why am I blanking on the name of that series that is about the mythical creatures of the Philippines, which is great, you know, like pop culture, just like K-drama, right? But anyway.
Frank has follow-up questions. To what extent do Filipino immigrants in the U.S. study the history of the Philippines? Mm. And then his second question. Well, let's answer his first question first.
Yeah. No, I love this question because I think even CUNY, right? There is this movement, at least in like the city and state systems, to actually make like Asian American studies, but then also these other kinds of studies like Philippine studies part of the curriculum, because you know, again, it's that silence, the violence of the silence of the archives, and so I think regionally we're at very, very different places. I mean, obviously, since the 60s and the 70s, you know, there have been folks on the West Coast agitating for this stuff. And in the East Coast, it's kind of like a fairly newer phenomenon. But to speak personally, I mean, when I was in high school, we did have a textbook. So I went to, I grew up in the Philippines and immigrated here around like 13 years old. And I do remember in our textbook kind of reading about the Spanish American War, and I remember like there was this photo of Emilio Aguinaldo in it, and so there was some mention, like maybe, you know, two or three paragraphs on what happened in the Philippines, but you never and I think Philippine scholars will point to this, that you never really hear about the Philippine American War, which is an extension of the Spanish American War. Because again, like in the United States, we like to craft this very clean idea of history. And even, you know, like the American Revolution, right? Like it's the irony. I mean, this is why, you know, part of why like, you know, Aguinaldo kind of believed in the Americans, right? Like, And actually, I don't know the history of the flags of Cuba and Puerto Rico, and if it's the same as the Philippines. But the red, white, and blue actually comes from the U.S. flag, because at least for the Filipinos during the Philippine Revolution against Spain, they, again, like kind of like the French Revolution, they look to the American Revolution as kind of like, you know, the philosophical ideals of that. And I think even, you know, throughout, you know, when Filipinos came to study in the U.S., this was during the colonial period, you know, as part of pacification, the U.S. allowed some scholars to come in and study in the U.S. I mean, they were very shocked about the racism that they experienced in this country, which just like when you just read about, you know, this the so-called mainstream history of the U.S. is whatever, like the benevolent colonizers, it was shocking to them to see what it really was, like their lived experience, which didn't match up to, you know, what was in the history books. So.
The show that we were talking about was...
Yes, thank you, Cesar. Yeah. Trece, yeah.
Trece. And speaking about Netflix, just the other day, as of the 21st, Netflix interface is available in Filipino all around the world. And it's also the subtitles and the dub is available also. And that's cool. Speaking about courses in history, right? Seattle yesterday debuted their Filipino U.S. history course in their public schools. So
awesome. Yeah. Yeah.
All during you know, Philam month, right?
Yeah. Yeah. I knew someone at CUNY would be plugged into this more than me.
Frank, thanks you for your answer to his first question. His second one is, an Academy of the Spanish language exists in the Philippines along with that of the US.
Hmm.
Only non-Spanish speaking nation to have one. Is there interest in retaining and or learning Spanish?
I might get in trouble for answering. No, I'm kidding. But there are, you know, it's interesting. There are some languages and dialects that are closer to Spanish. Like Kiligaynon, I think, and folks who are from those regions who are on this can probably answer this better than me, Chabacano. So it actually sounds like old Spanish. So if you go, you know, if a contemporary Spanish speaker kind of hears someone speak Chabacano, they're like, what is that, like, old kind of textbook Spanish that nobody uses anymore? So it's just fascinating in that way, that it's a language that's stuck in time and or influences of the Spanish that's stuck in time. But I know even, you know, during the period of Rizal, it's like all the intellectuals and anyone who was of the upper class did learn Spanish. I mean, Rizal wrote in Spanish. A lot of the intellectuals that we know today, the ilustrados, you know, they went to Madrid and were expats in Madrid and wrote critiques of Spain in Spanish, which is kind of cool. And that is what I love about it. I mean, I personally also learned Spanish, wrote it pretty well previously before I stopped actually taking Spanish class. But my motivations, and in the same way as a writer in the English language, it's like I want to learn the language of the colonizers to use it on the colonizers, you know, to decolonize. So it's interesting. I mean, I do think that there are probably, like, there's still a class thing that goes on. Like if your family speaks Spanish, that means you're usually like upper class or something. But I don't know. I mean, there might be kind of like decolonial reasons for also, you know, learning that language. Like, I mean, English, again, American English, it's like such a travesty in a way. The writer Gina Apostol talks about this, that when she was growing up, she was penalized for speaking Warai in the classroom. They would have to put like a coin in a piggy bank if they didn't speak English in the classroom. And so, yeah, to be penalized for speaking our own local languages, I mean, that's very depressing to me. And I do think that, you know, there are, when I was talking about the Twitter space with the linguists, that was kind of cool to me, that they, you know, they are studying all of the local languages and trying to even translate a lot of the material into local languages. That's like a big effort beyond, you know, beyond English and Filipino or Tagalog. So.
Now, Well, it seems Luis hopped off, but do you happen to know his creative process? How long it took him to actually write Black Henry, or you know, and develop?
Yeah,
it?
So I know that it was I forget now the grant that he got. He was in Cebu for a time, actually writing it there, and I think some of the first readings and workshops. I think there were two that actually. Happened in the Philippines in, what did I say, like 2003 or 2004. The actual length of time that he wrote Black Henry, because there was also, I'm thinking about another play of his, but and there was a reading here in 2014. So I don't know how long the process took, but if we are to learn from, I guess, like other plays that he's written and they get performed, subsequently, there's always like some kind of tweaking that goes on with each production, because he's usually involved in the actual production. So there's usually some tweaking of the script, I think.
Do you have any idea whether or not they might consider performing it live?
I don't know. I'm going to look at this attendee list to see if there's anyone from the production who's here tonight. We should have asked that question to Luis when he was here. But I don't know. I mean, that was the original intention, I guess, right? When he started talking with Claro. So there could very well be. Yeah, but it was great that they were still, because I do think they were timing it to the quincentennial, which makes sense.
Folks, if you have a question, please type in the Q&A box or raise your hand. I just want to mention, well, Vina did mention it earlier in the beginning. So this is our issue of CUNY Forum, of which Vina's essay appears in. So it's available online for you to purchase. We've also had Professor Isaac, he's published in our past issue before. But I believe the play itself that was done on Zoom is available online on the NYU.
I hope it's still. I know it was time delimited, but I don't know. Well, have you been on there recently?
And then there was a panel Q&A with Claro and Luis as well, with the
moderator. And Nerissa Balse, yeah.
So it might just be the, you know, on the website. But yeah. I mean, it could possibly still be on the NYU website for folks to view if after this talk.
Yeah, it was really cool. Very different. I mean, I don't know if you saw it, Anthony, when they did it, but it was just different from our conception of what Zoom is, right? Thank you all for being so engaged. I had fun. I had fun crashing into this academic space.
Well, I want to thank Vina again for a wonderful presentation. Great way to end Filipino American History Month. A couple days left.
That's right.
Please enjoy. If you're looking for other literatures to read, actually, the Asian American Writers Workshop has a list of reads available. You can visit their website to check that out. And with that, enjoy your weekend and remember to be upstander if you see a person in need. And good night and enjoy the rest of Philam History Month.
Thank you so much, Anthony. This is fun. Bye. Thank you, everyone.